Have yeah. any of your creations sent you to the hospital?
Not yet, but a lot of them have caused physical distress. Oh, no.
This podcast is hardly focused.
The French.
Trevor is the host of Cookshow. You can find him at Cookshow Trevor on YouTube, and he joins us here on Hardly Focused. Hello, Trevor.
Hey, guys. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for being here. Was it torture having to sit through your own video just now?
It was something. You know, you always think about things you could do differently, and that occurs with me often.
Yeah. That should be the slogan of Hardly Focused right there, in quotes. It was something. Trevor yeah. from Cookshow.
Yeah, good.
It sure was. I appreciate you guys picking that one out and playing that.
Yeah,
it's so funny.
I spent the afternoon watching, no hyperbole here, all of your videos, because I love the fact that they're all like a minute and 30 seconds long. Like right off Perfect. The bat, you seem to be catering to the ADHD generation, because that is like the ideal length for really any video on YouTube.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah. No, and I think, you know, I've tried to make longer form videos, but I don't know. There's not much you can say about a pizza that's like essentially a silly gimmick. Mm-hmm. So like, you know, sometimes I will recording a pizza, I will have like sometimes an hour worth of footage, and it'll just condense into a minute and a half. And yeah, there's sometimes it's like, okay, why am I doing this? But yeah, when it comes to like a silly pizza, the less said the better. So
now I thought the accent in your videos, now I thought you're exaggerating it, but I can hear it coming out while you're talking to us. Where are you based out of?
I'm actually from Colorado, and I couldn't tell you. So the accent, I have no idea where it came from. You know, what I tell folks is like, you know, they get East Coast from it, and I don't know, I guess like my family's from the East Coast, but they don't have an accent. My dad lived in New York for a good portion of his life, but he doesn't have an accent. I think it just comes from like TV and movies, you know? Mm-hmm. I'm like, you know, if you've seen Cable Guy with like Jim Carrey, you know, how like he was like overexposed to television yeah. growing up. That's like the whole plot of Cable Guy. That's kind of like me. And I think that's where the accent came from, was like, this kid was just in front of the television way too much. And it does like, there is a modulation. The way that I say it to some people, and the way that, unfortunately, like, you know, in personal life, like people are like, whoa, what is this voice coming out? You know, it's kind of like, you know how Jerry Seinfeld has his like Seinfeld voice, you know,
yeah,
really telling a joke, you know, and that's when the accent really comes out, when I'm like trying to be like, what's the deal with pizza? It's kind of like, you know, like it comes out then, when I'm really trying to accentuate a joke, all of a sudden it goes like full bore into that accent. So
it fits perfectly.
Yeah.
It's really nice. It's like a nice little accent to the pizza.
Exactly. It's like the extra topping.
Yeah, exactly. It fits. It's very unique to you. So never change.
Well, thank you. Okay.
Are you asking him?
The bank. Yeah. Never change.
Never it's change? A strong suggestion.
The way you said that reminds me of this from another one of your videos, Trevor.
I have become cheese.
So many fun sound drops.
Yeah, the Cheez-It pizza. Very quickly, just on the note of the film Cable Guy, and then pizza toppings, you have your website cookshowtrevor.com, where you sell your pizza power seasoning blend, and then I want to ask you about your thoughts on the film Contact, because I have never seen both a website that had the least amount of effort put into building it, and then a contact page where you pretty much just copied everything over from the IMDb entry of the film Contact. So I wanted to get your thoughts on that movie.
Did I? I have. Now we're going back. Yeah, you know, the website, is basically all of like Wix's, you know, if you go to Wix.com and you build a website, you could just like plug and play the templates. And yep. That is exactly what I did. Yeah, and there's a lot of stuff I don't even remember.
But you do.
Does it mention Jodie Foster?
Yeah, Robert Zemeckis, Jodie Foster. You've got like some of the crew on there too. It's brilliant. It just like looking at that, I'm like, this website's brilliant. But the Pizza Power seasoning blend. Now, assuming that's a real thing. And you're selling it for half price right now. Looks like
it is. Yeah, it's on sale. I got to get rid of these things somehow. no, it's a real thing, and it originally started. One of the ways that it started, but kind of morphed a little bit, was when I was going through my pizza making journey, and I was trying to get the perfect like pizza sauce. There was some things that I wish I would have known, mainly that monosodium glutamate is a key part of some good pizza sauce. And so like I originally wanted to make Pizza Power just to be something that's like, hey, add it to the sauce and like it will like, you know, it'll be all the things that you need in one. It kind of changed a little bit as time went on and I was developing it. And it changed mainly when I was starting to I was doing some type of video where I was talking about like old Pizza Hut pizzas, and they had a thing they called pixie dust that they put on the pizza. And it was like, you know, pixie dust was a stuff that like, I think went on their breadsticks too. And it, you know, of course that used MSG as well. Mm. And I was like, huh. And I wanted it to kind of transform it into that a little bit more. So it's great for sauce, but it's kind of turned more into a thing that'd be better for the crust, you know, nice little garlicky, buttery MSG seasoning for the crust. And it's pretty versatile. And yeah, it turned into that. And yeah, so that's Pizza Power. And of course, the name is inspired by a certain cartoon about four turtles that happen to be ninjas. I don't know if it's legal for it to be that name, but here we go.
Franklin?
Franklin.
Franklin. It came from
Was your mind blown when you found out that MSG isn't actually bad for you?
Yeah, and especially when I start researching it, where it's like, you know, there's so many things that like are bad for you in certain amounts. You know, it's kind of like monosodium glutamate can be compared to like sodium. If you have too much sodium, yeah, you're going to start having these ill side effects. If you have too much MSG, you're going to start having these ill side effects. It's just in moderation. Mm-hmm. It's fine. So, okay. Yeah.
If you eat too many strawberries, you die.
Exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, first,
do we know the number? Do we know the number of strawberries?
I don't know. I've been getting like these things in my feed of like this guy who fills up like a fish tank filled with like strawberries. First, it was French fries. Then it was strawberries. Then it was Monster Energy drink. And he takes the entire fish tank and he does like time lapse of him just eating it all. And people are like, this guy's dead.
Yes.
There's no way he can do this.
Yeah.
So
I think I saw him too. I think like last one was like Red 40 or something.
Yeah. it's weird. I don't know what I don't know why, but hey.
Internet.
Hey, internet.
Science, internet, views.
Like, yeah. Shock.
Why are we here?
Right.
Exactly. Where? Aren't we all the same?
Yeah, pretty much.
Zach, go ahead.
So I was like, I'm assuming I'm going to know most of probably what the answer is, because I feel like every time I ask this, it's very similar. But like, what kind of like got you to this point? Like, I'm assuming probably during COVID you had some inspiration, but like why pizza? Why Pizza Cook Show?
Okay. So this is like, my answer to this is so convoluted, but it does go way back. So you wouldn't know it by the production value of anything I've ever done, but I did go to school for film and television. All Where? The way back. So University of Colorado, but the Denver campus.
Okay.
And nice. Yeah, I think at the time I had like a special class on Saturdays. It was kind of just like a cobbled together class where five or six of us had it with the chair of the college. And one of the things back then, all the way back in like 2009 or 10, they were like, okay, web series. They were called web series back then when you'd make like, you know, a show on YouTube. Mm-hmm. It's like, mm-hmm. come up, that's the new thing. Come up with your own web series. And I had to like, I still have the paper probably somewhere. I said, it's called Cookshow. I wanted it to be like a nonsensical show about cooking where the guy was a complete like jackass and didn't know what he was doing. You know, like he completely, like he didn't know what he's doing, but he's still trying to teach you. And I even like shot like a pilot for it, whatever, like, you know, passed the class. And it was an idea that I kept on coming back to. And especially, you know, it was like, that'd be fun to do, you know, it's like, and then it was during COVID where I really started to try to hit it hard. And I wanted to be entertaining more than educational because I myself, I'm not culinary trained. I don't know what the hell I'm doing. And so at first it was just random foods. And I do impressions of like, you know, movie characters or actors. And that only went so far before I think I was on TikTok. And I think I was doing too much copyrighted music in the background. Mm. Where TikTok was like, okay, this account's had enough. Like, we're done here. And like, you know, everything I post was like at zero at that point. I was like, oh, okay. Time to retool it. And I thought, you know, I'm really not making this food that good. And maybe that's a problem too. So it's like, what do I actually make that's kind of decent? And, you know, I've been around the same time in college. I got bit by the pizza bug and started making, you know, pizzas like crazy. And so I was like, okay, I kind of know how to make pizza and I can make that a little bit more interesting. So let's do that, kind of make it simpler. And then, you know, add some other elements, like definitely a lot of inspiration comes from Epic Mealtime, you know, where they just go overboard in some situations and just cobbled it all together and just start putting them out week after week. And then it just kept going. And honestly, it sounds like I just said like, ha, there's a grand master plan. This is all part of the blueprint. Don't you get it? There is no blueprint. I don't know what the hell I'm doing week to week. So, but yeah, that's kind of how it started, what it morphed into, and I guess how we got to where we are now.
Nice. So, yeah. So, every video is you making a pizza with ingredients that more often than not does not go into or onto pizza. For example, the Five Guys burger that we played at the beginning of the show, Pop-Tarts. I was really fascinated by the water pizza that you attempted. now, do you have like just a running list of like every concoction you can think of, or is it just like something just comes to mind, or you're at the supermarket and you see a product and you're just like, that's it, that's the one, and then like next thing you know you're filming it?
It's definitely a little bit of both, probably more of the latter if I'm gonna be honest. Like there's ideas that I've thought of that'd be like, that'd be great or that'd be funny, but it's like, okay, that's gonna take me like 3 days to do, you know, it's like too complicated. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I definitely take suggestions from the comments. I write them down. I have like an Excel spreadsheet, actually like a few, because sometimes I don't know where I save them to, but I just have a list of like, you know, things and ideas. If I'm being honest, you know, if it comes down to like filming time, it's like, shoot, I need to get something out there and it's gotta be easy. So I'll be sitting there in the supermarket just staring at like a few things and like, well, okay, let's put SpaghettiOs on a pizza. So it is a combination of both, to be honest.
Okay. So. The water pizza, like I mentioned, that one, I went into that thinking like this is going to be the funniest disaster ever because like it's water, like you're literally putting ice cubes on pizza dough. And then I love that, spoilers, you ended up making, and I can't pronounce it either, is it cacio,
cacio e pepe?
Yeah.
Yep.
That,
yep.
Was that, did that end up actually being delicious? I imagine like at the end of everything, it actually would have come out pretty good.
It was okay. And that was kind of one of the things where it started out in design that I was going to make, you know, I have tried to like keep up with weird pizzas. And there was one I had seen, it had been on YouTube for quite some time, the cacio e pepe pizza, where I'd seen like, there was actually like a pizzeria, I think it was maybe in Italy somewhere, where they, you know, they made the cacio e pepe pizza where they put ice cubes on there, and not too many ice cubes. And then it came out and they just put like olive oil and a bunch of pepper on there. And like, everybody was like, yes, it's so exquisite and delicious. And you can call it cacio e pepe pizza, or you can call it the water pizza, because that's what it is. You're putting water on a pizza. And so that's where I was like, that's kind of a funny premise. And really, oh my goodness, it could have been good. And I think that's another tagline that I could probably use. It could have been good.
That's my life.
Yeah.
But I think if you ever watch the YouTube video with it, I couldn't tell you what the video is. They put like, you know, maybe two or three ice cubes on there. Mm-hmm. I just dumped ice cubes on there.
Why not?
The ice maker bin was filled, and you're just like, you know what? That's it.
Yeah, I'm fully loaded.
Yeah.
It could have been good, but there was so much water on it that just like was overflowing, and it ended up kind of being soggy and burnt at the same time.
Yeah. On that note, is there like an ideal temperature to bake your pizza at, like something that you typically land on, or does it vary depending on the toppings and the ingredients that you're putting on there?
There definitely are some varying temperatures, you know, especially because I do have an idea each time of what I want the pizza to look like. You know, I'm trying to do funny things, but I don't want to necessarily gross people out too much. Mm-hmm. So there'll be some things where it's like, I know I want like a nice cheese that has like some golden brown spots on it. So then I'll like lower it down. Or if I know like, hey, I'm just going to blast this thing, I will crank up the heat. Ideally, my temperature is around like 600 to 650 that I cook at. But given like my format where I am preheating the oven while sitting in front of the camera, like yapping away, sometimes like when I finally come out with the pizza, it's like, well, it's at 850. So we're going to have to figure this out quick. There is that ideal temperature, but whether I adhere to that is another story.
One of the things that I love about the videos is if you watch enough of them, you can kind of tell that like there's oftentimes a look of why am I doing what I'm doing in your eyes that I just love. It's just palpable. It's just like it tells such a story of who this character actually is. And the other thing I like too is that a lot of the pizzas do actually end up like looking like, huh, that actually looks like you, like the idea, like you brought the idea to like full fruition. It may not have been
edible,
a great idea, but you did it, and here it is, and it looks nice sometimes.
Yeah. I appreciate that, thank you. And yeah, that's the goal, because truly one of the things that I aim to do at the same time is not waste food. So I know at the end of the day there's one guy who's going to be eating this thing, and it's me. I have tried to pawn it off on several occasions to friends. but so I do attempt to kind of steer it in a way where it's like, what is a way that I can at least like, you know, I made like a candy pizza where it's just like a bunch of like jelly beans on top, where it's like, okay, I want to at least be able to eat the jelly beans later. It's like, let's make them, so let's add them on the end so they don't melt, so I can pick off the jelly beans and eat them, you know. So
nice.
Have any of your creations sent you to the hospital?
Not yet, but a lot of them have caused physical distress. Oh,
no. What's like the worst one that you've made? Have there been any that haven't made it to video form? You're like, I can't show people that I did this.
Actually, I think most of them have made it to video form. And I mean, there's been somewhere, I think there was a Panda Express pizza I made once, and it wasn't bad. Like the Panda Express part, actually, wasn't gonna be bad, but there's some things that you don't see where it's like that one was dropped on the floor, like just face first, just on the floor. And I just sat there for 5 minutes, maybe looking at it. I had to like cobble it back together.
Oh no.
And in that video, I don't think you even see me talk or say anything. That would have been humorous. But like at that point, I was like, cut camera one. I'm just going to film the pizza. And like, that's it. That's the closest it's gotten. And it ended up looking okay. But yeah, nothing that's actually, there has been nothing that's been cut. So fingers crossed.
So one of the things I'm curious about is like your process. I know it's like so cliche to talk about it, but I'm curious, like you have so many funny little one-liners that are like thrown in. Do those come to you as you're doing it, or do you write it before? Like, I love don't tell Rupert.com. Like just weird things like that. And you also do some weird editing things where like you split up some of the words and it's like, there are little tiny Easter eggs that you hide in there. And I'm just curious, like, does that come before? I'm imagining each bit of those comes during the process, but what's your process like?
It's a mixture of both. Some of them, I am thinking of a pizza idea and I'll come up with a general script, because sometimes I've had the unfortunate situation where I skip over like mentioning what I'm doing or like saying the topping. So I do have a general script. And sometimes if there's a kind of a funny thing that I know I want to hit on, I will write it down. But yeah, a lot of times it comes within the process. And I think that's the best videos. There's been some videos where I've had it completely written out and it's just like, eh. You know, and sometimes you can just tell, it's like, that was paint by numbers. But the best ones always come with, you know, I just have the camera rolling. I didn't even think that was going to come out of my mouth, you know?
It's really funny. Like, I don't even know, like, if it's intentional, but there's one part, I think it's in the lobster one, where you're like, and that's about as good as it's going to get, like it's like, and it just like, it's so, I love it. It's really well crafted. Who's your comedic inspiration? Cause I definitely can tell that you are a fan of comedy.
Yeah. I absolutely love comedy, and I wish I could pinpoint a single inspiration, but I don't know if I have one. You know, like, I don't know, some of it is just so, like, early on in the episodes, it's almost like a little bit more Mitch Hedberg, where it's just kind of like, so,
you know? I could see that, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then later on, I can tell you. But yeah, I love all comedy. Like, that's kind of like, you know, I wouldn't say that, like, I love pizza, I love what I'm doing, but, like, the pizza's a Trojan horse, if you will, yeah, for like, you know, some comedic performances. It's not really about like the pizza, like, you know, it's kind of like, yeah, here's how I can get some jokes at you.
Well, it's really well done. I do stand up, and I'm subjected to people doing stand up every week, and this is how I end up watching a lot of my friends that were, I wish I could support them, but you know, like, you subject yourself to comedy for so long, you kind of like get how it works and everything. And you're just kind of like, nothing really surprises you, but your videos, I'm watching them by myself, like cracking up. And that is just so good. Like, so unique. Cause like, there's not much, I've watched like comedy specials on Netflix where I'm like, okay, that was a good bit. Like, you know, just nodding like and agreeing. But like just some of the quirky, weird bits that you put in there to just catch me by surprise are some of the funniest things I've seen. So thank you for putting those in there, and don't stop being yourself, man.
Oh, well, Nate, thank you so much. I tell you, I admire what you do going out and doing stand-up comedy, because I tried to do stand-up. I think I did an open mic thing, I don't know, last October. And oh boy, I have, you know, one of the things that I have the luxury of doing is having like, it, you know, the pizza is like my prop, and I can lean on it for material. And if it's not funny, just like, you know, especially with the format I do, cut it out, or just like, let's make a joke about the pizza. But yeah, being up there with a microphone and just, you know, that, I think I did a like 10 minute bit on Fergie, and that just bombed. Nobody cared about my Fergie jokes. So yeah. And
yeah, it, 10 minutes of Fergie, you gotta cut it down to 5.
I think it's like 10 seconds. It needs to be like, Fergie.
Were any of your jokes about her pissing herself on stage?
No, I didn't know that happened.
What? Oh, you guys don't remember that? She was, I think it was after she left Black Eyed Peas, and she was doing like a solo show, and she just straight up just wet herself like mid-performance, and it was somewhere like big too. And it to say it went viral, I mean, this was, you know, almost 20 years ago now, but yeah. Anytime I think of Fergie, I'm like, the chick that peed herself on stage. All right.
Well, yeah, because that's not funny. That's cool. Haven't you seen Billy Madison? Peeing your pants is the coolest. Yeah.
Peeing your pants is cool. Call me Miles Davis.
That's the grossest thing I've ever heard. That's cool.
The most disappointing, I think, moment of my life was after spending over a decade quoting it, I finally made my ex-wife watch Billy Madison with me. And at the end of the movie, she says, what is this? What did I just watch? Was this supposed to be funny? And notice how earlier on in that story, I said ex-wife. I will leave it at that.
That was the change. Like,
well,
Norm MacDonald in it. He's
she was like the moderator during the academic decathlon.
Yeah,
I what you said. No points, and may God have mercy on your soul.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, a simple wrong would have done just fine, but
wow, that was perfect.
I have that. I think I have that whole thing in the library here. And I also have this as well.
Everybody on, good, great, grand, wonderful. No yelling on the bus.
It's such a great movie.
I know. That's one of those ones that you could just sit and just quote and realize you've effectively quoted every line in the script.
You know what I quote all the time and people never pick up on it? When they ask, like, what day is it? And I'm like, I don't know, October? Because Norm MacDonald just has this one weird line that it was like the, so I don't know, it's so, but no one's picked up on it. I love it.
I heard, you know, and this may not be correct piece of trivial information, I heard that Norm MacDonald was actually kind of wasted during that scene.
Probably.
He actually did have a few drinks.
That sounds about right.
Yeah.
I used to work in radio, and I had the, fortune of meeting several celebrities during that time, one of which being the late Morgan Spurlock. And I always forget that I met him, but he was on that list. But Norm MacDonald visited our radio station one morning, and I was like, I got to a point where I learned how to contain myself around famous people and not be starstruck. And Norm, I was just starstruck in front of him. And he like comes up to me and he like, you know, extends his hand. He's like, I'm Norm. And I'm like, hey, nice to meet you. I'm Jack. And he just goes, sweet. To which I just go, Turd Ferguson. And that was it. And then when Norm, God rest his soul, passed away a couple of years ago, all I could think of was I had every opportunity. I could have talked to him about anything. I could have asked him anything. And all I did was just say the name of one of his characters from Saturday Night Live. And that was it. And then just took like a mediocre photo with him.
That's just as good, I think. The story itself is something to be treasured.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But he was, all that aside, he was cool. He was a treasure. I miss him. I miss him every day.
Yeah, one of the greats.
Going back to performing live, have you ever thought about taking your performance on the road?
Oh, no. I have never thought, like, I couldn't even, I haven't even thought about, like, there's situations where I thought about, how do I make this even, like, live for social media audiences? Mm-hmm. And I'm kind of working on that, but, like, still haven't even come up with anything. But on the road, that would be interesting.
I feel like you'd have to do, like, what the chefs go on, like, the daytime talk shows to late night shows, and they do like the incredibly fast cooking segment. And,
oh yeah, yeah. They have everything prepared. And
yeah, everything's prepared. They have the ingredients, but then they have the final product already made. I feel like that's like what you could do. It's like before the gig, make the concoction and have it, and then kind of do like a mock, you know, assembly stage of it, and then at the end of it, take out the already finished pizza and then sample it and then give your review there.
Or have somebody from the audience come up.
You could do that too. Yeah. See if they concur.
Come on down. Yeah.
Yeah. Try the pizza.
you have to sign this 60-page waiver first.
Yeah, exactly. Do not sue me. I would love that. Then that's a great idea. And that is something that, you know, when I've looked into production of how, you know, a lot of cooking shows are done, I'm like super envious of, where like real cooking shows on the Food Network and stuff, like they already, like Good Eats, Alton Brown, I learned that like he had a team back there like making the final product, you know. Mm-hmm. And it's like, yeah, that would be so nice just to pop it up like, here it is. Bam. And have people, but yeah, that format could definitely work, and that would be so much fun. Well, if I ever get on Good Morning America, Jack, I'm I'm gonna do that. I'm stealing your idea.
Hell yeah. on the topic of Alton Brown, is there any like celebrity chef? I don't know, it's like celebrity chef, because obviously there are chefs, well-known chefs out there that aren't celebrities, but are there any in particular that like one day, fulfilling a dream, you'd love to collaborate with?
Oh yeah. I would be way, way embarrassed too, because then, you know, they get to see behind the curtain that no culinary knowledge, you know. They'd be like, yeah, that was working with a jackass. But I would love, I mean, Alton Brown, like I'd love to work with Alton Brown, because he actually was how I first learned how to make pizza dough. I watched his episode on making pizza dough so much that I told somebody, I had a dream last night where like, it was like Back to the Future, but instead of Doc Brown, it was Alton Brown. And like, we need to like get into the DeLorean and go back to like my, I don't know, my elementary school, like cafeteria, and make pizza. It was weird, but yeah, I would love to do something with like Alton Brown, because he was the first person that I ever saw that prioritized entertainment along with actual food. Like everything he did was kind of like a Bill Nye, the Science Guy type situation. Mm-hmm. Props, he'd use different setups and like, you know, have these all these skits. So like, to actually be able to ever do something like that with him, but like now I think he's entered into a different stratosphere of, you know, whatever. So but yeah, Alton Brown. And then of course there's so many big personalities on you know, YouTube and TikTok that I'd love to work with eventually. But again, it's like those people obviously have culinary experience. They're actually making real things and teaching people, and I'm just here, you know, doing my thing. So
yeah, but you're like the comedy part. You're the entertainer. Yeah. So like, don't sell yourself short at all. Cause it's like, yeah, sure, anybody could cook pizza, but no one can make it entertaining in the way that you can.
Right. And you know, the TikTok, the YouTube chefs too. I mean, they certainly aren't, worms and dirt pizza. Like that probably the last thing on their list they want to make. Imagine you being there working with them and being like, okay, so here's
like a professional making
here's a bunch of pizza. Yeah, hard boiled eggs on pizza dough. Let's do it.
Here's this ridiculous idea that I've had that sounds awful and we probably shouldn't do it, but if we were gonna do it, I would need actual skill, which is where you come in. So please help me make this ridiculous idea that shouldn't exist is basically how you should approach it.
Right. Because you know what they're going to do is they're going to try to make something like that, something just outlandish, and they're going to end up making some sort of like culinary masterpiece that's delicious. And then Trevor, you're just like, no, that's not the point. You missed the point.
Yeah. Wait a minute. It's like a lot of times I'll get comments that's like, you know, the reason why I mess things up is because I throw it all on the dough and cook it at once. And a lot of people are like, hey, doofus, you should have par-baked the dough. it's like, oh, yeah.
My fiance is a bakery or works at a bakery. My fiance is a bakery. That explains the call. My fiance works at a bakery, and I showed her a bunch of your videos, and that's the first thing she said. But I'm like, but that's like, that's part of the process, you know? Like that's what makes it unique, you know? You can't. Yeah. I don't know. It's unique.
You got to mess it up somehow. You can't.
Yeah. No, it's great.
Well, you're talking about splitting the ingredients, and then you have the Wendy's pizza with the fries and then the Frosty. And I was I love that you just wrecked all of your equipment with the melted Frosty, but I was surprised that you didn't put the Frosty on first. I'm curious like how that would have came out if you put it on and then baked it.
Oh, yeah. Well, I did a little bit. So I did do a little bit of both. But when you put the Frosty on first, it just ran off. Like there was nothing left by the time it came out of the oven, where I was hoping. And, you know, it could have been my fault and how I stretched the dough. Actually, it was probably just nature that ruined me, because the Frosty melted immediately and just ran off the sides. And I was hoping that the crust would make like a little, you know, like kids' swimming pool of
Ooh, I had an idea. Okay, so on that note, McDonald's. We talked last week about Grandma's McFlurry, and I tried it shortly after we recorded that episode. Now it is not made with real grandma, which you know, that is some blatant false advertising, but it's delicious. You should try making a pizza out of that.
Okay, I need to know, what is the Grandma's McFlurry?
It's got like little chunks of like butterscotch candy, and then like butterscotch and toffee like mix in, like just flavored goo, and it's supposed to taste like the candy that Grandma would have either in her purse, or you know how like old people and like grandparents always have that bowl of candy that you've never seen it in stores before. But, you know,
it's got like the butterscotch, it's got the peppermints, it's got the strawberry things, and they're all mixed together.
And that you feel like they should have dust collecting on them, but they don't.
It's got the, I think they are, I think the name of them is the Werther's Original. Yep. Those little caramel candies that like exclusively are bought by senior citizens.
Yes.
So, yeah.
And me.
Absolutely.
I mean, I got sick and tired of cough drops, and then those butterscotch candies made so much. Never mind. I'm just.
Well, I'll tell you, it's shockingly delicious, and I, you know, it's not going to be around for very long, but I was actually surprised at how much I enjoyed it and wanted more. I can only imagine what that would taste like. As part of a pizza, I imagine you'd probably want to mix some other stuff into it, maybe McDonald's fries or McNuggets or what have you. But and then even by itself, it's pretty good.
I think we got to, okay, this is it. I will say this. We are going to make this pizza. I don't know if it's going to be tomorrow, if it's going to be a week from now, but I got to capitalize on this, and we got to make it full of grandma cliches.
Yes.
We got to have like all types of grandma cliches throughout the whole episode.
Yeah, definitely.
And you should try to see if you can find those candies, like the ones that they mentioned, like the strawberry candy, for example.
Yeah. Just a dish sitting there, like on
there's
the counter.
Probably, yeah. I think they sell it at like Costco.
Or Dollar Tree, you know,
BJ's, or I don't know what you have near you, but like the big department stores. What's the
Market Basket?
What was the Walmart version of that? What is the Walmart superstore?
Sam's Club.
Sam's Club. Do they still have those? Are those?
I think
still
so. Around?
Maybe where he lives, but not around in Massachusetts anymore. They all closed.
They do have Sam's Club still, and I actually just was at like a family cookout where they were all trying to indoctrinate me into Sam's Club.
It's always how it works.
Yep. Yeah. It's like you got to get a membership. Well, get this. If I could plug Sam's Club for a little bit, because maybe I have been indoctrinated, they have a thing and it blows my mind. So, you know, Costco, I was complaining about Costco where I went in to get like, you know, those little K-cup coffees. Mm-hmm. That's all I wanted. But mm-hmm. I go in and the line for the checkout is all the way back to like the meat and cheese department. It's like, okay, well, I guess I can do without coffee. And so I just put it back and left. But they were like, well, you didn't do the scan and go? It's like, what's the scan and go? And they said that Sam's Club has an app where what you do is you go around and you scan the barcode of the products, put it in your shopping cart, and then just go to like, you know, you pay on the app, and then you go to the exit, show your ID, show the app, and they're like, yeah, okay, you can go.
Okay.
And like, That's
the future.
That's something. I mean,
well, Nate, you live close to, we have a supermarket chain up here called Stop and Shop. And Nate, you actually live like literally down the street from one. I don't know if they still do this, but they had that exact system there. And I
was that Peapod.
Well, Peapod was their delivery service. Okay. What, you know, long before like Instacart and all of that, there was Peapod, but it was a handheld scanner you'd pick up at the entrance and you walk around, scan everything, pay right there on the device. Or I think you'd pay like up, like,
you pay at the register. So
yeah,
he's in the future. So,
oh, okay. Yeah.
Trevor is in the future. The one step that's above.
Okay. Cause but, I was working at Stop and Shop when they introduced both this system and the self checkout machines. And it was just a hilarious disaster on all sorts of levels, especially when going back to the grandmas, the old people were trying to figure it out and getting frustrated because it was modern technology.
They also have a robot that cleans the floor.
Oh God, the robot scares me. Oh, dude. Yeah. There's like a robot. It's like a giant, like what it, it I don't even know how to describe it.
It's just a giant rectangle with googly eyes.
Yeah, they put giant googly eyes on it. It's great.
Slowly follows you.
It's terrifying. You turn the corner and then there's just this robot just there that you're moving it like a fraction of a, you know, mile an hour, just cleaning stuff up. But if you're not expecting you to see it, it scares the just shit out of you.
It's like the robot from, have y'all seen Rocky IV? Where they bring the robot in to wish happy birthday to Polly. And it comes in. Sudden, like the lights go low and this robot comes in and it's bringing in his birthday cake. And like, they just come up with like this techno music and he's just like strolling in slow and it goes, doo, 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 happy birthday, Polly. And it's like,
it sounds amazing.
It's a hilarious scene. And that's exactly what I think of when I hear that. That this robot is slowly sweeping the floors in this grocery store.
Is it this?
Happy birthday, Molly.
love his little red hat.
What is this?
Your present.
Yo, I wanted a sports car for my birthday. Not no walking trash can.
Come on. And I imagine that's how the older folks probably reacted when they were greeted by the cleaning robot.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's really funny.
Yeah. Actually, I think they have now, and the pandemic kind of brought this into the forefront, but now they have like early shopping hours at various stores. You know, they're, you know, marketed as different things. I know like Walmart calls them like, you know, sensory friendly hours, but I know, you know, the elderly, they get a specific time right when the store opens between like 7 and 8 a.m. where they can go in and shop and they don't have to worry about the scary robot making its rounds. And
I think it's Marty or something like that.
It's some human name.
Some weird name. Yeah.
It's a human name that doesn't make any sense to give to a robot. It's just synonymous with fear now. all right. The scoring system that you have for your pizza. So this is a very obviously elaborate scoring system. Everything is awarded a 7 out of 10, it seems. Why 7 out of 10?
Well, I mean, the truth is, like, you know, even when pizza's bad, it's good, right? Like that's kind of, I think, the essence of it, but it came from a couple different places. One, I think the first few pizzas I made were legitimately 7 out of 10s, but then, I don't know. I was watching, I don't know if y'all have seen, Dave Portnoy from Barstool Sports, who has become insanely famous for going around to pizza places and reviewing pizzas.
Yep.
He'll go outside and he'll do, like, you know, his thing is one bite. He'll do one bite of the pizza and give it a review. And he gives all types of scores. Yeah, like, you know, they're like 7.2, 7.8. And he rarely gives anything that's like a 9 or a 10. And sometimes if you really piss him off, if you're like, I don't know, he goes to like a place where the owner was rude, or if he goes to like Chuck E. Cheese and has to go through the rigmarole, he'll give it, you know, a really low score. But if you look at them all, I watch so many of those, they're kind of like in between 7.0 and like 7.9. He just puts a decimal point behind a 7. And it's like, these are all 7s. How's he getting away with this?
That's funny.
And so that was a little bit of the inspiration there. But yeah, it really comes down to, you know, some pizza I find great, and I was like, someone would hate this, or some people, or some pizza I was like, I hate this, but some people like it. And so it's a 7.
After you give your score at the end of every video, you should play this as well.
Not great, not terrible.
not great, not terrible. That's how it is. And there's something always salvageable about these pizzas. Like I said, if I'm making a candy pizza with jelly beans, I'm having jelly beans for the next week, just picking them off the top. So it's not all bad.
Yeah.
Are there any pizzas that you wish that you didn't have to give a 7 out of 10? Like, you're like, this sucks. This is the worst thing I've ever made. Oh, 7 out of 10.
Oh, yeah. Some of them I circumvent. Like, I think it was, there's been a couple where I don't give the pizza a 7 out of 10 because I couldn't bring myself to do it. Like the popcorn pizza where I filled the dough with popcorn kernels. And I swore, I was like, this oven's at 650. These things are going to pop like crazy. I'm going to have a dough filled with popcorn. None of them popped. None of those kernels popped. And like, I even topped them with popcorn kernels. None of those popped either. Like, honestly, I don't understand the thermodynamics of making popcorn, but it just didn't work out. And so I dumped to make it, like, you know, to salvage the video, I just put microwave popcorn on top and then like chipped my tooth on like a couple of the popcorn kernels. I didn't actually chip my tooth. But I was like, my scoring then was, should I give microwave popcorn a 7 out of 10 and just left it at that? Cause I couldn't give that pizza anything. You know, there's been somewhere like I circumvent what is essentially a 0 out of 10.
Has there been any you made where you want to give it higher than a 7 out of 10?
Oh yeah, several times. And there's been ways that like I kind of, you know, because honestly, like some of them are true. There was like the first one where I really was blown away was when I made like a jalapeno popper pizza where I filled the crust with like jalapenos and cream cheese, and it was fantastic. But I say in it, I was like, this is a 10 out of 10, except for, well, I burnt the crust a little bit. And the truth of the matter is that was one of those times where I was talking for way too long and like it heated the oven, preheated up. So you can't see it in the video, but yeah, the bottom burnt a little bit. So even though it was a fantastic idea, I had to grate the, if you would have seen the, like, I don't know, if someone was to actually eat that pizza and post it on Yelp, they probably would have flipped the pizza over and took a picture of the bottom and like, yeah, look at this. And so yeah, that did bring it down. I wanted to give that a 10 out of 10. So there's always little things that I can say. So we're our own worst critic.
Of
There are
course.
the little things where I can say, no, it wasn't perfect, not yet. So,
Now, I'm assuming the answer to this is all of them, but have you ever made a pizza that looked just absolutely disgusting, but then was actually really delicious when you took a bite?
yes. And let me think about which that one that was. Oh my God. Okay, so this is, I'm going to take you on a gross journey here. It
Nice.
was it was the Burger King. So I make a Burger King Whopper pizza where I just slapped a bunch of Whoppers onto a
I
pizza
remember this one.
and cook it. And what was so gross about that one was I have a schedule in my mind where I'm like, okay, I'm gonna get this done in one day. And there's a thing, I don't know if it exists anymore, it's called Whopper Wednesday,
That
where
still
like you buy.
exists.
Perfect.
Let me tell you this. I'm putting on some pounds. Whopper Wednesday still exists.
Yeah. And so I was like, I gotta capitalize on this while they're cheap, you know? And so I get a bunch of Whoppers and I'm like, all right, I'm gonna get this done. But as you know, life happens, I ended up not getting it done on Wednesday. I didn't get it done on Thursday. I didn't get it done on Friday. And those Whoppers are sitting in my fridge.
Oh.
And so it's like, I invested in these. I'm gonna make it. And so I take these old Whoppers out of the fridge and throw them on it. And it's like, this is gonna, and you know, they had all the toppings on it too. Like they had
Yeah.
the lettuce and stuff on there. I was like, this is going to be inedible. And by all means, it should have been. But I took a bite of that, and damn it, if it wasn't delicious. Covered in ketchup. I covered all the burgers just in loads of ketchup, you know, cheese, and then cooked it. And those 4-day-old Whoppers held up on that pizza and actually tasted good. And
Wow.
yeah, I don't know what to say. I was blown away. And I didn't reveal it in the video because I think maybe that was like, there's, like I said, there's always that line of gross out that I don't want to necessarily cross. So I didn't reveal that in the video, but that is definitely the hidden truth.
I got a question. So the opposite of that, what's a pizza that you were expecting to taste really good that was just god awful the moment that you put it in your mouth?
Okay, I gotta think. Let's see. One thing that I didn't think was going to be as objectionable was the kiwi pizza, where like
Yeah.
I didn't think that was going to be objectionable, or the salad pizza. So the kiwi pizza, I'll say about that was disgusting. I don't know if I had bad kiwi or what. I don't know anything about kiwi, but like it just like was rancid. Just the smell and the juices permeated everything. And I thought, like, you know, I'd had banana pizza and I was like, that's not bad. Banana pizza really isn't that bad. Kiwi pizza was putrid. And the same with the salad pizza. Salad pizza is one of the few ones where I actually made with some friends over. You can hear them in the background of that video laughing as like I like nearly like vomit from eating. But I was like, you all try it. Try it right now. And they were like, yeah, I don't know why, but salad pizza was disgusting.
Have you ever tried making durian pizza.
I was just about to say that. Holy shit. What the fuck? I was going to be like, dude, you got to make durian pizza because that shit will go viral because people are always like talking about the durian being like the worst fruit. Let me give you a little sample of what this fruit experience is like. It's a fruit that is just obnoxious and offensive to all of the senses. It's spiky, it's squishy, it smells like
this
onions. It smells like onions. It tastes like pudding and onions, and like it's just, and in a lot of places you can't have them. Like there's little signs that say you can't have a durian here, like hotels. They're like, wow, no durians. Like, oh, they forbid the fruit there because it's so stinky. Like it is so bad. Like the taste, the feeling of eating it is kind of like a pudding mixed with booger. Like it's like the got the squishy.
It's a really bad sensory experience. Yeah,
but isn't it? Like, but it's delicious. Isn't that like the crazy
it's
thing?
Supposed to be.
It's supposed to be, but it's not.
Yeah. Okay.
I think it's like
you pop it open and it's like, is it white with little like spots in it? Is that the one or no?
It's kind of like, it kind of looks like the inside of like an alien stomach.
Yes, yeah.
It's just like kind of weird looking. Like I don't know how else to describe it, but I don't know. Maybe it's the same situation with the kiwis. I just got a bad one, but from what I hear, everybody talks about how awful they are. So like they're really eye-catchy for, you know, somebody made a dirt, like, you know how everyone's saying like pineapple on pizza is the fucking worst, and then they like, hang on, hold my beer, and then they'll send the link to your durian pizza.
That's a good idea,
because I want to see in the video you just like opening the fruit and reacting to what it smells like.
Yeah, you definitely have to have some behind the scenes stuff, because I don't know, it would be interesting. But that's so funny, Jack. I literally Googled durian right before you asked, because I was like, it's a durian, right?
You Googled durian. I Googled, what's that fruit that smells awful? And now the AI overview that was recently introduced in Google, and I have a follow-up question for you, Trevor, about that, but I know it's been getting a lot of flack lately, but according to the AI overview, so durian banned in public places in many parts of Southeast Asia, including Singapore's rapid mass transit and hotels. And it goes on to say, in Indonesia, the smell of a durian once grounded a flight and caused pilots to make an emergency landing in Canada. And then in Australia, the smell of a durian once caused a dorm to be evacuated after residents thought there was a gas leak.
So yeah, maybe make this one outside.
Yeah. Okay. I'm glad I got that warning.
But like, it has the potential. Like, I would hate for you to do it, completely ruin your establishment, and like, it gets like 10,000 views.
Ends up being his most popular video ever.
Yeah. It reminds me of, it's like that that scene from Anchorman with the cologne or whatever.
Oh, Sex Panther. Yeah.
That scene was like,
smells like Bigfoot's dick.
It's a turd covered in bird hair.
A diaper filled with Indian food.
So the Google, they introduced their AI responses, and predictably, it was a disaster upon rollout. One of the most infamous things to come out of it was it was telling people that if your pizza toppings do not stay on, apply glue. Do you agree with this?
It's just given terrible advice.
It was pulling its data from, like, I think the glue thing came from like an Onion article or something like that, but the AI's just like, yeah, seems legit. If your toppings are sliding off your pizza, just a little bit of Elmer's will fix it right up.
I was just about to say, Elmer's glue, yes, solves everything. And Elmer's glue and duct tape pizza. There you go.
There you go. That could be a fun like April Fool's episode.
Yeah.
Where you do that and you're like, you pretend like you're going to eat it and freak everybody out. And you're just like, then you give it to Marty the robot.
Not great, not terrible.
Not great, so, not terrible.
I looked it up and it's described as having a strong smell of a combination of sulfur, sewage, fruit, honey, and roasted and rotting onions.
Oh my.
So like people know this as to be like the thing, but for some reason in Breath of the Wild, it was like the fruit that gave you all your health back. I don't know what they were thinking, because in Tears of the Kingdom, durians were not in the game at all. Sorry, I'm a Zelda fan.
Oh, but... I'm a huge Zelda fan.
Oh, hell yeah. There we go.
So, but yeah, I don't know. Like that's an idea. I don't know where the hell you would get a durian. But
oh, you just got to find your local Asian supermarket, because they probably have it, because I went to one near me a couple of weeks ago and they had them there. It's like, oh, well, good to know that that's there and not anywhere where I can smell it.
Yeah. Yeah, I think with that description of like it's like smell and flavor profile. Who's like torturing themselves with that, you know?
It's like a delicacy somewhere. Like yeah. I don't know for some reason. Why.
Yeah, I don't know. So it must be something that people either do to it that makes it like all of those weird flavored things.
I think there's a
Google like people also asked. Why do people eat durian?
Well, there we go.
Well, like I said, I was in the presence of it, and I can confirm it smells awful, and just that alone deterred me from it. But people were consuming it. They're like, this is delicious. You got to try some of it. And I'm like, no. Something that smells that bad can't be that good. But the majority opinion was that it's delicious. So I would imagine... I just want to see what happens if you do crack one open, you put it on pizza, and that ends up being the 10 out of 10 you so desperately want to give.
It could happen. It could happen. We don't know. And I mean, maybe Zelda Breath of the Wild was onto something. Maybe there is some type of regenerative properties for durian fruit.
It's regarded as an aphrodisiac.
Ooh, okay. All right.
So that's why people are eating it. I get it. The Viagra of fruits.
It's used.
Put
in
hair
folk
on your
medicine.
Chest.
Yeah, I don't know, man. That's an idea for you. I'm sorry, and you're welcome.
Well, on that note, Trevor, what are you playing lately?
I have gone through. I'm playing a lot of Nintendo Switch, and I actually am replaying Ocarina of Time in 64 right now.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't know how I beat it as a kid, because I am going back and forth in between YouTube and like Game Facts and everything, trying to figure out where everything is. It's so cryptic. And,
yeah,
you know, all the hints they give you in the game are not
puzzles
helping.
Themselves. They're like riddles, and you're like, cool, thanks. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, how did we ever beat those games, you know, younger without, like, you know, having the resources where it's like, you know, I don't know. It's been fun. Don't get me wrong, but man, is that game cryptic.
They made those games that way specifically because back in those days, they couldn't make a long enough game, so they had to make them hard as hell.
Yeah,
so exactly. That you feel like you get your money's worth.
Back then, it was really just like word of mouth, having a friend or knowing someone that seemed to know everything. Because I remember being stuck in Sonic the Hedgehog 3, mm-hmm. Carnival Night Zone. There's these barrels that you need to like get past that. Like if you don't know what you're doing, and if you don't have access to the instruction manual too, which I didn't, then you're not going to know what to do. And you're going to think, well, I'm stuck. I'm never going to get by this. And one of our co-hosts whom I've grown up just bitching to it about him one day. And he's like, oh, you just got to hop on it. And it just like press up on the D-pad. And I'm like, I love,
how would you ever know?
I'm like, I love you. Would you love to host a podcast with me in 15 years?
Some people figure out things about games that are just, it's just wild. Like if you go over to this corner and jump seven times, you cut right through the side of the level and then you fall through and then you beat the level.
Okay.
And
I'm so, like,
how do people figure that out?
You joke about this, but the Tomb Raider remastered collection, it came out a couple months ago. So there was like a health pack that's up in like a ledge that was like you could not access unless you stood in a specific spot and just kept like jumping backwards against a wall and hitting it and doing it enough times that it would glitch you through the ceiling, drop you down on that ledge, and you can get the med pack. In the remastered version, they actually give you an achievement and a trophy for doing that, and they and they didn't patch it out.
That's great.
That's funny.
Video games are cool.
Here's my theory too. I have an auxiliary theory too. Is around that time, I remember seeing, because I used to get like Nintendo Power magazines and stuff when I was a kid. And I remember there was a hotline that you could call into sometimes.
Yeah.
Even like they put it on the back of like the Game Boy, the original one, where it was like, hey, you stuck?
Nintendo hotline, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, where it's like, it was one of those ones where it was like, you know, I don't know how much they charge you per minute, but it was to get, you know, someone to walk you through. And it's like, maybe it's all just a cash grab scheme too. And there's been some old games where I've like gone through where it's like, this is a Nintendo hotline game.
Yeah. So I was a Sega kid growing up, and Sega had the same thing, and it was on the back of the boxes, it was in the manuals, and it was like the Sega tip line or something like that. And I distinctly remember the logo was like some like pseudo Bart Simpson looking kid holding an oversized Genesis controller in one hand and his phone in the other. And I'm pretty sure it was like $5.95 a minute or something like that. It was
that's crazy,
ridiculously overpriced. But I, at the same time, was always tempted to like beg my parents to let me call it, because I was like stuck on the river raft level of the Jurassic Park game and like couldn't beat it.
That was our version of, I think, you know, girls at the time, they had to like chat with Corey or whatever, you know. That was our chat with Corey.
Yeah,
a list of words that rhyme with Corey. Story, gory, allegory, Montessori. I quoted that on Instagram like 2 months ago, and I'm still, every day I'm getting notifications of people still liking that comment. And it wasn't even on anything like Simpsons related. It was on like a picture of Corey Feldman, like out of his mind for some reason. And I'm like, here's a line from The Simpsons. And people are, I watch that show. That's funny.
They're never yellow.
Never gets old, though. Never gets old.
Your favorite Zelda game?
Favorite Zelda? Man, I'm going to catch so much flack for this. It's a controversial opinion. I really, really like Skyward Sword. And I think it's because I bought that Wii. I bought a Nintendo Wii. Saved up my allowance. Bought the Nintendo Wii because I saw the advertisement that like made you feel like it was like the first thing I ever saw that was like VR in your, you know, in your actual like room. And I thought like, you know, I mean, obviously everything that came out on the Wii was nothing close to that. And I wanted to finally be able to swing a sword and like feel like I was actually Link in like Zelda. And that was the first one where I felt like it. And oh my goodness, I played that thing to death. And for some reason, it still sticks with me. I love Skyward Sword through all of its flaws that are many flaws. But I love that thing. God damn it, I love it.
You must have really strong forearms.
Well, I've been practicing. Like I said, I've been practicing up to that moment. I've been training for this all my life.
That was re-released recently, right? Didn't they remaster that on the Switch?
They did, yeah. They did.
Okay. I feel like people were upset that it like they were charging full price for a remake of a near 20-year-old game.
Yeah. Yeah. And it definitely opened my eyes a little bit because I was swimming in nostalgia. And it opened my eyes a bit to a lot of its flaws. Because on the Switch, too, if you play it handheld, you're not swinging the remote around. You're using, like, you don't have your motion controls anymore. So your face to, like, actually look at the video game for what it is. Mm. And did it change my opinion? Yes. Did nostalgia still win? Yes, it did. So Skyward Sword still like still top dog. But that's actually kind of why I started to play Ocarina of Time. I'm actually going through all the Zeldas right now to try to like figure out if my opinion is correct or not.
Okay. Well, you scared me for a second, Trevor, because when you said it's controversial, I thought you were going to say Zelda's adventure for the Philips CDI. Like, like those ones that Philips came out with and like Nintendo has since then like disowned and been like, that's not part of the timeline.
Well, you know the backstory behind that, right? Like why that exists.
They like contacted Philips to make like a special or Philips was making like a special video game console, and they contracted Nintendo to see if they could license Zelda, and they're like, yeah, sure, go for it. Mm-hmm. And then they didn't know that they were gonna make what they made.
Yeah, it's a
I thought it was gonna be good.
Yeah.
Well, it was a larger result of Nintendo and Sony working together to produce the Nintendo PlayStation, which was supposed to be the answer to the Sega CD. It was supposed to be a CD peripheral for the Super Nintendo. And then Nintendo just randomly decided, we're not going to work with Sony. We're going to work with Philips. So Sony said, well, screw you. We're going to go make our own console with hookers and blackjack. And that's where the Sony PlayStation
Futurama.
Came from. Yep. And then the Philips system never came to fruition, but as you said, as part of the deal, like, well, we still need to fulfill some contractual obligations. So we got the masterpiece that is that Zelda game. And then there's some
it's so bad.
There was some like
please,
Mario.
Please skip those ones.
There's like
the Mario one. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't know there was a Mario one.
There's a Mario one. It's real bad.
But it's like a puzzle game, right? It's not even like an adventure game.
Yeah, I think so. I've never played it.
Yeah.
That sounds about right.
And it's worse than like, I don't know. There was like, did anybody play Where in the World is Mario? Or what was it called?
Yes.
Mario Around the World or whatever.
Yeah, there was two games like that. There was one where it's like, where is Mario or where is Luigi? And then there's like another one where like, I forget, like, you just, like, do something, you're in a castle, then all of a sudden you're surfing, and then you're like, what am I doing? And then you hit a whirlpool, and then all of a sudden you're in Italy.
Yeah.
Like, I can't remember the name of that one, but yes, I vividly remember, because my mom liked playing that one. For some reason.
What was that on? What platform was that
It on? Was a Super Nintendo.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, and like a moment of silence to all kids who got that on Christmas or their birthday. Imagine
Oh, no, no. A moment of silence for that game and also Super Nintendo Lion King because, man, that's probably been responsible for breaking so many Super Nintendos.
The Stampede level.
Yeah.
Yeah, where they came out and they said, yeah, no, we intentionally made that level so difficult because we realized we made the game too easy. So instead of making it moderately difficult, we just made it impossible for kids to beat.
Yep.
Oh, yeah. I never got to be adult Simba. Never did. I don't know.
Yeah, nope.
I don't know what it's like playing as adult Simba. Probably fun.
No, it's hard.
For me.
I think...
I got past that level once, and then I died immediately after once I got to the name.
Oh, you know what's even worse? It's the level with the fucking giraffes. And
yeah.
Like the monkeys throw you in the trees and you have to get that one fucking drove me bananas.
Hey.
but this line has been forever ingrained in my head from that game.
It starts.
Yep, same.
Yeah.
Same.
Yeah. Sorry, I just had a tangent.
My line, I think, is there a line that like Rafiki says when you like have to hit the continue button where it's like you press the continue button, it's like he has returned.
The king has returned.
Yes. I can't tell you how many times I heard that because of how many times I died.
the game drives me crazy.
And if I remember correctly, that the cover art too isn't even pleasant. It's like adult Simba like looking over his shoulder and like yelling at Mufasa. Mm-hmm. And Mufasa's just like up on a ledge giving him a shit-eating grin like, ha ha, killed your father.
Yeah, we should have took that as a warning. Don't buy this game. Don't
play it. All right. Yeah.
Well, you live and you learn.
Yeah.
Before we wrap this up, Zach, did you have any final thoughts?
I mean, I guess that the internet has spoken.
Okay.
No, but
I
like
said about it myself.
I do feel like there's a niche out there that you are definitely filling for just like, I don't know, there's something about just seeing what you come up with next that is very entertaining. And like also like the part, the little chaos gremlin in me is like, yes, what other evil things can we do with pizza?
Oh yeah. And it may be infinite. It may be infinite, or it may just be until like the internet's like, okay, let's push this guy to the side. Like, we're tired. You never know what the internet's gonna do to anybody. So we'll see how long it goes, how long this wave is until it, you know, we're all tired of it. But I'm here as long as people are happy and excited by it. I'm gonna keep doing it, and yeah, we'll see where this goes. So
Nate, final thoughts from you?
Man, that was a cool question. I don't want to like follow it with a stupid question. But how do you flatten pizza dough? It drives me crazy. My fiance, like we try to make every month, we try to make like a macaroni Alfredo pizza where we just like, we take the dough and I try to flatten it out. I bought this big piece of wood, like a roller, to try to like roll it out and try to get it as flat as possible. And then I cook some pasta and then put some Alfredo sauce on it. But it always, the dough always ends up coming out to be like a big thing of bread. And yeah. So tips on getting that dough to be flat as can be.
Yeah, super. So you want that super stretchy dough. And what I'll say is like, you got to, one is like, knead the living hell out of it. You know, I have never really, the only like the stretchiest dough I've ever made has always been not kneaded by hand, but kneaded in like a stand mixer or something with a dough hook. And then another thing I do is I use high gluten flour. And one thing that is super helpful, this is a nice little secret. If you happen to have, you can't buy this in like normal grocery stores. You got to go to like a restaurant supply store. They have something called bromated flour. And it uses potassium bromate in it. And potassium bromate is one of the things that will allow you to stretch a pizza until like now and forever. And it is, unless you're in California, because it's been banned in California, because
like the durian,
it is one of the substances that is possibly cancerous.
Oh yeah.
So you take the good with the bad.
Like you said, moderation. You know,
everything in moderation. Circle. Yeah. So that's one of the things. If you're really struggling and you're really like, man, I want to make that thing that's like basically like a cape flying in the air. Bromated flour is like an easy way, but I'd say high gluten flour is the best, because like, you know, gluten is like essentially the protein strands within dough. And when you're kneading it, you're aligning these protein strands to connect to one another. And the more you knead it, the more they're going to align. And then you get to a dough that can actually like with that gluten really stretch. That's why with like gluten-free pizza, like, you can make gluten-free pizza fine, but you're not going to toss that thing in the air. You're not going to really stretch it out with your knuckles. You're going to have to flatten it on a flat surface and kind of spread it out that way. But yeah, high gluten flour, a lot of kneading, and just maybe a little bit more oil in there. It helps condition those strands. So,
all right. Running it all down.
Yeah.
Thank
That's
you.
That's how it goes.
Well, I'm just like, just was thinking, I'm like, do I have any pizza themed sound drops in the board? And I have one of Jason Kelsey saying this once on Instagram.
That's right, because everyone in this house loves pizza.
And I don't know why that amused me so much, but it did. And then there's King of the Hill.
I know pretty, pretty pizza, but I'll tell you what.
And then
is fun. That Bill doing Boomhauer? Sorry.
Oh, that's they're all working as volunteer firefighters, and they're all trying to recount what happened when the firehouse burned down.
That's right.
Boomhauer's, like, yeah, yeah. Boomhauer's memory. It's the only time in the show when you hear him speak normally, and everybody else speaks like Boomhauer.
Yep. That's a good one.
Pretty, pretty pizza, but I'll tell you what.
And then finally, my favorite.
Yes, this is Jesus Christ, and I just broke into the Pizza Hut. I broke the window in, and I'm here. Jesus is here now. He's back to Earth.
What is that from?
One of the best 911 calls of all time. It was Jesus. Jesus, he was back. He came back to Earth.
Jesus Christ.
I would have. I played all those because I would have, like, 2 days from now, been like, I had all these sound drops and I should have played them. Why didn't I do it? And I figured I'd just throw them all out there now. So on that note, Nate, thank you for sharing that with the group.
I posted in the chat a picture of Marty if you want to see it. I feel like you just want to. It's like, yep, it's very close to that guy. Like the
no kidding, it is. How terrifying! Why did they?
It kind of looks like, you know, you'd see. I don't know if you guys have ever, like, just randomly scrolled through shorts and you've seen those random like back room like themed like horror shorts. It looks like something where if you were like playing a game where it's like a supermarket at night, that like Five the Nights robot would just stop moving all of a sudden, and then like spider arms would come out of it, and then it would turn around and look at you. And it's like, yeah, you know, it does kind of look off-putting.
It's horrifying.
It makes your shopping experience so much faster. Let's speed run.
Trevor, thank you for joining us here on Hardly Focused. We really appreciate it.
Of course. Well, thank you guys. This was so much fun. So, yeah, I really appreciate you guys having me on and all the great questions.
Yeah, of course. His name is Trevor. He hosts Cookshow on YouTube. You can find him at Cookshow Trevor. You can also find him at cookshowtrevor.com, where you can get the Pizza Power Seasoning Blend for $8.99, because he's got a lot of it.
Oh, yeah. Get it while you can. <All right. laughs>